Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of North Star by Hammond Innes, narrated by Jack Hrkach. This book is copyrighted 1974 by Hammond Innes. This recording is copyrighted 1982 by Recorded Books. Mike Randall, a former union militant, refloats a trawler wrecked in Shetland and goes into partnership with the owner, Gertrude Peterson, trying desperately to put politics behind him. But the police and his ruthless former comrades have further use for him, and Randall is drawn frighteningly close to the centre of an attempt to destroy an offshore oil rig. And now, North Star.
Part 1. The Trawler. 1. It was March. The wind cold from the northeast, and the fishermaid plunging down the waves with a wicked twist to her tail. I shut the door of the bridge behind me, leaving the skipper to listen to the forecast, and went down the ladder, heading aft to check the gear. I knew the forecast would be bad, but it couldn't be any worse than the weather we had had off Bear Island. I paused in the shelter of the superstructure. Here, on the starboard side, I was out of the wind, and I took out my pipe, filling it automatically, standing there, staring out across the darkening sea. I had seen to the stowage of the gear myself, 1,000 miles back, when we had finished trawling. It was just an excuse to be out in the open, away from the smell of oil and stale food, the blare of the radio, and the company of men I had been locked up with for too long. On a trawler, it's bloody difficult to be alone when you want to. Shetland was still just visible, the black humps of the distant hills like wave patterns against a cold green strip of sky, and the light on Sumborough Head blinking above the hard line of the horizon. Only that pale green strip to mark the bitter cold we'd been steaming through. The rest of the sky was clouded over now. A flurry of sleet drove like a veil across the starboard navigation light. Inside of 2 days, we would be back in Hull. And still I hadn't made up my mind. The shadowy figures, the crash of glass, the sudden blaze of bottled petrol, and that child's face at the upstairs window. It had haunted me throughout the voyage. Slowly, the pale light faded in the west. I stood there watching it until that last vestige of the dying day was engulfed by night, wondering whether the strike would still be on, what the hell I was going to do. Waves were breaking against the stern, the driven spume white in the gathering wind, and the wind whistling in the top hamper. I was thinking of my father then, wondering what he would have done, giving his life for a cause in a country not his own. Would he have allowed his principles to be totally destroyed by a single cruel and senseless action? The match made a small, flared arc as I tossed it over the side, my hands gripping the rail, the metal cold to the touch, my eyes staring westward to Shetland, 15 miles away. He had been born in Shetland, and I had never been there. I hadn't even known him, only the legend. My mind slipped back, my life in flashes, and always that legend, a guiding light to everything I had done. And I wasn't sure anymore. A door opened, the muffled sound of the radio reminding me of the industrial world just 2 days steaming away. The docks, the stuffy, smoky meetings, the arguments, the pickets, the turmoil of overpopulation, man in the mass. Christ, how could one man, one individual speck, find his way in the tangle of motives and pressures? Mike! I turned, glancing upwards to see Sparks standing at the top of the ladder, his thin hair blowing in the wind. The bridge door slammed behind him as he came down to stand beside me, a sheet of paper thrust towards me. I pushed it away. I don't need a forecast to tell me it'll be force 9 before the night's out. It's not the forecast. His thin, rather high-pitched voice was half blown away by the wind. A message for the skipper. Well, give it to him then, I said irritably. I have, but since it concerns you... I could smell the beer on his breath as his pale face thrust closer, the eyes bright behind his glasses. You in trouble? How do you mean? Look, Mike, he said, you were shipped at the last minute after Les Sinclair had gone down with a virus. You and the skipper, you're not buddies like Les, so he may not tell you. I thought I'd warn you, that's all. The police will be waiting for you when we dock. A Detective Sergeant Wright. Here's a copy of the message. And he pressed the piece of paper into my hands. Thanks. They want to interview you. I suppose you know why. Yes, I know why. I stuffed the paper into my pocket, staring out into the night, saying nothing. I had been afraid of this all through the voyage. Somebody must have recognized me. And now, when I stepped ashore, the police would be there, wanting a statement. And if I gave it to them, if I admitted I knew who the men were, then I would be a witness for the prosecution, and the decision would no longer be a personal one, something between me and my conscience, and made of my own volition. It would be the result of police interrogation. At least, it would seem like that to everybody but me. Do you want any sort of a message sent? A private message? Lawyers or anything like that? He was still standing there at my elbow, a man whose world was the ether, who fed on information dragged out of the air on invisible wavelengths, his curiosity glowing in his owlish eyes. No, I said. There's nothing a lawyer can do. He hesitated, standing there beside me, waiting. Doubtless it was kind of him, but radio operators are all the same. They want to be in everybody's confidence. In the end, he left me, and I was alone again, watching as the ice-battered trawler plunged southward down the North Sea, each surge and twist carrying me closer to the moment of decision. But you don't change the whole direction of your life because a child is nearly burned alive. Or do you? The storm was rising, and in the end I gave up thinking about it and went to my cabin, lying there, sleepless and fully clothed, the ship's plates writhing to the violence of the movement. I was back on the bridge in time to get the news. It came right at the end, the talks broken off and the strike still on. Weeks now, and every shipyard in Hull at a standstill. Did that mean Pearson and Watt were out too? The skipper was there, and he turned and looked at me. You hear that? And the pump's going full bat. They'd been going flat out ever since we'd hit the ice. They'll get us home, I said. He didn't answer, moving to the port side of the bridge, his carpet slippers flapping loosely. He wasn't a big man, but there was a lot of strength in that short, long-armed body, the round bullet head, almost neckless on broad shoulders. And he had an inner strength, his silences more telling than words. He stood there for a while, staring out into the murk ahead. Better get some sleep. It's going to be a long night. I nodded. It was his watch now, and I went below, checking the engine room and the hold. The fish pounds were just about full, almost 2,000 kit. That would be about 20,000 stone landed, a lot of it high-priced. Worth the bashing we had taken up there on the edge of the pack, and my share as mate looking good. The fact that she was low in the water did not matter now. We were running with a quartering sea, and the pumps were holding. If we'd been steaming into it, things might have been different. It was a long night, all right. At 4 a.m, I was back on the bridge, visibility almost nil, and the big deckie they called the Porpoise with his eyes glued to the radar screen. The skipper was in the chart room working out a deca position. His thick, hairy hands juggled with the parallel rule, penciling a cross just east of our intended course. Winds veered a point, pushing us more than I thought. He ordered a correction to the helm as he entered up the log, and then, instead of leaving me to my watch, he slid the chart room door shut. 3 weeks now. You heard what they said on the news. Every yard and hole at a standstill. He had his broad bottom wedged against the chart table, his slightly protuberant eyes fixed on me. Every blasted yard. He pulled his pipe out and began to fill it. When did you first go into trawling? Some years back now. I asked when. Spring of 1969. The Lady Betty. Old Harcourt. Shipped as a deckie, did you? I nodded. And your mate's ticket 4 years later. He lit his pipe, solid and immovable as the ship fell off a wave top, sending the rule and dividers skidding across the chart. I don't understand you, and that's the truth. A bloke with your education... He shook his head, frowning. Still got your union card and all? Yes, but not the whole trawler's officers. Shipyard, isn't it? I didn't say anything, and he grunted. What made you switch to trawling? My own business, I said. Aye. He took the pipe out of his mouth, his eyes staring. But just tell me. I'd like to know. I laughed. What could I tell him? The sea, I said. It's in my blood, I suppose. You were at the Marston Yard on Clydebank, a member of the strike committee in 1968. And before that, you were in prison, result of a demo that tangled with the police. That's a long time ago. You're still the same bloke, aren't you? Come to the point, I said. All right, I will. Pearson and Watt now, if they've come out. Sounds like it. And they're non-union, all of them. Young Watt won't employ union men. So where do we go for a refit? Not my problem, I said. No, not your problem. But you're doing, I reckon. Then you're wrong. He shook his head, an obstinate look on his face. You're a good mate. I grant you that. But you're a troublemaker. I wouldn't have shipped you if... He stuffed his pipe firmly back into his mouth. If what? I asked. I was doing you a favor. You were short of a mate. Aye, but it didn't have to be you. And then he shrugged and said, All right, I'll tell you. Jimmy Watt asked me to take you. Get the bugger off our backs, that's how he put it. And then his big forefinger was jabbing me in the chest. Do you deny you were on the committee? Not on the committee. I was called in to advise them. Advise them, eh? His voice was still quiet and under control, but the hull accent was stronger now, something building up in him, an undercurrent of menace. Advise them on what? Intimidation? He leaned his round head closer, the gray eyes cold and fish-like in the hard light. Or did they call you in to get at Jimmy's foreman? To get Bob Entwistle to... What the hell are you talking about? I was suddenly angry. Remembering how I'd walked out of that crowded meeting, the little congregational hall thick with smoke and full of violence. You know nothing about it. Don't I? Well, I know this. You listen to me. I was shouting, and I reached out and grabbed hold of his shoulder. Don't you dare! He slammed his big fists down on my arms, wrenching himself free. Keep your hands off! Just listen, I said. It was the economics of the strike. The future of the yards, the financial state of shipbuilding in the Northeast. They were scared about their jobs. He glared at me. They don't care about their jobs. They don't care about anything, just so long as they can smash us all to hell. You may be right. What was the point of arguing with him? I suddenly felt tired. My watch, I said. You'd better get some sleep yourself now. Why would they ask you about the financial state of the shipbuilding industry? I was trained as an economist, London School of Economics. You know so much about me, you should know that. I turned to the chart. What do you intend to do? You can't make another trip without a refit. There's a leak forward where we hit that growler. I don't need you to tell me that. He relit his pipe, staring down at the chart. There's no rush. I'll have a word with Jimmy in the morning. Aye. He nodded to himself. We've a little time yet. And he turned abruptly, without another word, and left me alone to my watch. It was a long 4 hours, nothing to relieve the monotony but the slowly changing position of an oil rig seen only as a blip on the radar screen. The wind was gusting 50 knots, the ship standing on her head and no visibility in the blinding murk of sleet and spray. Plenty of time to think, and my brain was too tired, too numbed by the battering to work out what I was going to tell the police when we docked. There had been two of them, two shadowy figures, and then the crash of glass, the sudden blaze, their faces lit as they turned and ran. I switched on the Deca Navigator, concentrating on the clicking dials to get a fix, doing it automatically, knowing I could identify them both, and worrying about Bucknell. Claxby I didn't care about. He was an older man, a hard-line militant, brought in to cause trouble. If it had been just Claxby there on his own, I wouldn't have hesitated. But young Harry Bucknell was the son of a good, honest shipyard worker who had marched to London with the Jarrow boys in the 30s. A postgraduate university student, intelligent, and an anarchist. At least he had done it out of conviction, believing that violence was the path to revolution. And I had no doubt who had been the ringleader. I entered up the fix and went back to stand by the wheel, staring out into the black night. All I had to do was tell the police, tell them the truth. But it was the charge that worried me. If I hadn't been there, if the little girl had died in that fire, it would have been murder. The charge could still be attempted murder, and myself in the witness box, the full glare of publicity, and everybody knowing I had been interrogated by the police. It would be my evidence alone that convicted them. I would be cast in the role of a Judas. And they hadn't meant to harm the little girl. They hadn't known she was there. All this time I was pacing up and down, the bridge tumbling under my feet, the noise of the storm beating at my ears, the elements in tune with my mood. Everything in chaos, the world, my life, everything. Was this a sort of crossroads in the long journey from womb to grave? If only there was somebody I could turn to, somebody to lean on, to give me strength, to tell me what the hell to do. I was thinking of Fiona then, wishing to God that just something in my life had turned out right. And then a rogue wave came out of the night, hitting us on the quarter, water roaring along the port side, and as the ship fell off the top of it with a slam that hurled me against the man at the wheel, I heard him cursing under his breath. Our eyes met, and his big mouth opened in a grin. "Them lads ashore, all tooked up in bed with their womenfolk, makes me laugh on a night like this."
"Why?"
"'Cause they don't know when they're well off, always itching for something. Me, I just want what they got. Right now I'd settle for the missus, all warm and cozy-like, and a soft bed that didn't move unless I made it." He grinned, winking an eye, the longing of weeks at sea on his face. My watch ended, and I went to my bunk, lying in the dark, thinking wearily. I was an idealist, and idealists get cut down to size when ideals are transposed into politics. Maybe I wasn't tough enough. When it came to the crunch, was I a coward then, my ideals shattered by a petrol bomb? But the doubts had started long before that. When was it? At that Clydeside meeting, when a small group of militants screamed fascist at me because I had tried to spell out for them what would happen? I had dried up and handed the mic over to a man who talked their language, not the logic of falling orders and redundancies. Was that when the doubts had started? I couldn't be sure. It was such an accumulation of things. It was just on 10 when I went back onto the bridge. Daylight now, a gray world, cloud and sea all one in color, and the whitecaps rolling in from dead astern. I glanced at the gyro, and then at the skipper.
"You've altered course."
"Aye." "Aberdeen?" He nodded, his eyes on a small freighter headed for Norway, and making heavy weather of it as she butted the tail end of the storm.
"Did you talk to Watt?"
He didn't answer me, and after a moment I ducked out of the bridge to the door of the radio room. The fug in that little cubbyhole was overpowering, the air thick with smoke. Sparks was thumbing the key, tapping out a message in his shirt sleeves, a cigarette burning beside him in a rusty tobacco tin full of stubs. I waited, sweating there, until he had finished.
"Any news for me?" I asked.
He picked up his cigarette, turning in his chair and looking at me, his dark eyes large behind the steel-rimmed glasses.
"You know we're headed for Aberdeen?"
Morse crackled from the loudspeaker, and he reached out tobacco-stained fingers for his message pad, listening with his pencil poised.
Then he relaxed. That rig again. So much traffic for Redcoat 2, I've hardly been able to send it all, and the old man desperate to jump the queue and get us slipped. He hasn't notified the Aberdeen police. Not his job to do that. The office knows, of course, so maybe they have. He leaned back, his eyes fixed on me, but half his mind on the Morse. They're waiting to haul anchors, so I suppose they got no joy in the Bressé Bank. Les is fit again, by the way. And he added, sorry about that. The old man'll be sorry, too, in a way. Les isn't the best mate in the fleet. What do you do when we get in? I hesitated, wondering whether the police would be waiting for me at Aberdeen. Go on the club again, I suppose. One trip in 6 months. I was hating myself for being so dependent on trawler owners for employment, conscious of a deep-seated urge to start something on my own. Why don't you switch to oil? Supply ship, something like that. That's where the future is. Trawling? He shrugged his shoulders. Doesn't matter to me. I go where Marconi sends me. But a man like you, with a master's certificate, you want to go where the future is. He jerked his head at the sound of the Morse. He's talking to the tug owners now, a big German job steaming north from Heligoland. The forecast's good, so they'll be under tow tomorrow night. Every trip it's the same, down past Brent and Auk, all this area of the North Sea, nothing but rig talk. Blue Water, Stayflow, North Star, Glomar. Take my advice. I listen and I know. There'll be more rig supply ships than trawlers soon. Maybe. I stood there for a moment, listening to the crackle of the Morse. Clydebank, Newcastle, Hull, all the political involvement of my life. My mind switched to Shetland, to the islands now far down below the horizon. Was it the island blood in my veins that had made me abandon capitalist America as a kid? Was that why I had started on my wanderings, seeking the values I could not find in the rich world my mother had embraced? Or was it the legendary figure of my father? Had I built him up as a hero in my mind simply because she had tried to bury him? I didn't know. My mind was confused. All I knew for certain was that everything I had done, everything I had believed in, had suddenly turned sour. And then Sparks murmured, "The offshore capital of the world." He coughed over his cigarette. "Aberdeen, you know it?" I shook my head. "Never been there." He smiled. "Well, that's what they call it." The Morse ceased, and he glanced at the clock, his fingers reaching for the dials, tuning to the emergency wave band. "Take a walk around the harbor when you get there. Have a look at the pipe storage depots, the diving outfits, all the clutter of stuff the oil rigs need. You'll get the message then, all right. Aberdeen's no longer a fish port. It's an oil rig supply base, and if I were in your shoes..." He stopped then, his body suddenly tense as a ghostly voice, calling in clear, began repeating the single word, "Mayday, mayday, mayday." The voice was urgent, giving details now. It was a trawler with its engines out of order being swept onto a rock-bound coast in heavy seas. "Shetland." Sparks was scribbling it down on his pad, and as the voice began to repeat the vessel's position, he glanced up at a large-scale map. "Looks like he'll drive ashore on Wallsey Island." He ripped the sheet off his pad and got to his feet. "Nothing we can do about it, but the old man better know." And he hurried past me, through into the bridge. The name of the trawler was the Duchess of Norfolk. We looked her up out of curiosity. She was just under 200 tons, built at Lowestoft in 1939, and owned now by G. Peterson of Hamnavoe, Shetland. New engines, 1968, Paxman diesels. So what had gone wrong? All the chief said was, "Bloody Shetlanders, they wouldn't know a crankshaft from a camshaft." He didn't like the Shetlanders, having been stuck there once with gales and a leaking ship. The Duchess of Norfolk was, in fact, south of Wallsey, and, with the wind backed into the northeast, she drove toward South Nesting. We caught snatches of radio talk, very faint, as the trawler ranger steamed to her assistance. It gave me something to occupy my mind, following her progress on the Shetland Isles chart number 3059. She cleared Muckle Flattercap, a bare 3 cables to the eastward, drifted inside Mucklebillen and Litlebillen, missed the rock islet of Climney by a shift of the tide, and hit Fiskaskerry at 1346. By then, the trawler Ranger was almost up with her, and inside of half an hour had a line aboard. That was the last I heard of her, for we were already in sight of Aberdeen's North Pier, with the city showing gray through the murk above the pale line of the links, and I was busy getting ready to dock. The skipper took us in, heading straight for Albert Basin, where the trawlers lay. As we approached Point Law, a survey vessel sweeping past us and a tug maneuvering across our bows, the harbor area began to open up. Sparks appeared at my elbow. "See what I mean?" He nodded towards a cluster of tanks to starboard, with supply ships moored alongside. "Mud silos," he said. The area beyond was being developed, the sound of reconstruction work coming to us across the water. "That's the future you're looking at." It was an extraordinary sight. The whole harbor area crowded with ships, drilling ships, survey vessels, seismic ships, tugs, and ancillary craft, all jam-packed among the fishing vessels. And upriver from Torrey Harbor, a litter of pipes and buoys, equipment of all sorts, lay piled on the quay, more mud silos, and a new berth nearly completed. As we moved slowly into Albert Basin, we passed very close to Point Law, and the supply ship bunkering there. It was the first time I had been really close to one of these flat-bottomed, tug-like vessels that keep the rigs drilling. "I only know trawlers," I said. Moored there, the ship looked very sleek, very efficient, but I had seen one once heading out to the Brent in a strong westerly gale, seas breaking over the flat, open afterdeck. I'd rather have the Fisher Maid up around Bear Island than one of those in a North Sea gale. He shrugged, his eyes smiling behind his glasses. "All I'm saying is, if you got in on the act, you wouldn't be short of a ship for years, not the way new rigs are coming into service." A trawler passed us very close, another just ahead of us, as we nosed our way down the length of Albert Quay, searching for a berth. I could see the fish market now, and then a gap opened up, and the skipper said quietly, "Looks a likely hole. Reckon there's just room for us." He ordered port wheel, our bows swinging, and I took the loud hailer out onto the wing of the bridge. We were tied up by 1400, the lumpers offloading the catch. Since Aberdeen was not our home port, there was no pay, only subs from the local agent to see the boys home. They had a long rail journey ahead of them, and most of them were away by the time the first pound boards were being replaced and the emptied compartments hosed down. The skipper called me to his cabin. He was packing his bag. "You in a hurry to get back?" He knew I was the only officer who hadn't got a wife waiting for him in Hull. I shook my head. He was standing, holding his shirt and a bundle of dirty socks in his hand, a slug of whiskey on the locker behind him. "I thought not." The bulging eyeballs stared at me. "Take it then you won't object to staying the night aboard. We've no ship's husband here, you see, and Les doesn't arrive till tomorrow." He waited a moment and then nodded. "Good, that's settled then. Better use my cabin so's you can keep an eye on things, like." The lumpers packed it in shortly before 1900, and then I had the ship to myself. I sat on the bridge smoking a pipe and watching the lights come on as dusk descended over the city and the high land behind it. A stillness had settled on the basin, the quay deserted, except for the occasional figure moving along the shadowed wall of the sheds. A siren blared briefly, and a trawler up near the entrance started backing out. I watched it as it headed for the open sea, thinking of the mate preparing his gear and the ice ahead, and the skipper wondering where the hell he'd get a catch that would satisfy his gaffers. After that, the port seemed dead, nothing stirring. Night had closed down on Aberdeen. I tapped out my pipe and went to the galley to collect a plate full of shepherd's pie and veg the cook had left for me. The galley stove was still warm, and I put a kettle on for coffee. With the coffee, I had a glass of brandy from the officer's ex-bond locker. A cat had come aboard, and as I drank, I watched it stalk its prey in the shadows cast by the deck lights. To be suddenly alone on a ship gives one an odd feeling of isolation. All during the voyage, the Fisher Maid had been alive with men, an organized unit of activity, her hull vibrating to the pulse of her engines, resounding to the noise of the sea. Now it was deserted, a hollow shell, inactive, still and strangely quiet. I had time to think now, but somehow I seemed unable to concentrate. I was tired, of course, but I think it was the stillness and the quiet that prevented my mind from focusing clearly. I finished my drink, went down to my cabin and packed my gear, shifting it to the skipper's cabin in the bridge housing. Then I turned in. I was in my pajamas, having a last smoke, when I heard footsteps crossing the gangway, the murmur of voices. I went through into the bridge and out onto the wing. Two figures stood talking on the deck below. "Looking for somebody?" They turned at the sound of my voice, their faces pale in shadow, something slightly menacing as they stared up at me. Then one of them moved, coming out of the shadows to the foot of the ladder. "Heard you were still aboard. We'd like a word with you." He started up the ladder, a short, burly figure, his round, pugnacious face framed in dark sideburns, eyes deep-set, and a full-lipped mouth. "Remember me?" I nodded, the sight of him taking me back to that angry meeting in Hull. He was a Newark man, and nothing to do with the shipyards. His name was Bob Scunton, and he had confronted me when I was still trying to address the meeting, prodding me in the stomach and telling me to belt up and stop talking a load of statistical rubbish the lads didn't want to know. The other man I had never seen before. "All right," I said, "you can come up." And I led them into the bridge. There was only one seat, so we stood facing each other, and I didn't like it. I had the feeling of being cornered. "Well, what is it?" "Last month, the night of the shipyard workers' meeting." Scutton's voice was slow and deliberate, his eyes watching me. "You got a little girl out of a burning house and handed her over to the neighbors. Didn't give your name. Just handed her over and slipped away, right?" I didn't say anything, standing there, waiting, conscious of the other man with a slight cast in the left eye that made his gaze oddly disconcerting. "Thought no doubt you wouldn't be recognized." My mouth felt dry. All my fears now suddenly realized. I knew Scunton, knew his reputation. These were men who operated in the shadows, maneuvering and motivating others, controlling events. They weren't union men. They weren't members of any political party. But they were always there in the background whenever there was trouble. "Come to the point," I said. "All right, I will." He licked his lips, his eyes darting round the bridge. "What about a drink while we're discussing it?" "It's been a hard trip," I told him. "I'm tired." "So are we," he growled. "Soon as we heard you weren't putting into Hull, we came north." He thrust his head forward. "You haven't talked to the police yet, have you?" "No." He nodded. "Okay. But when you do, what are you going to tell them? That's what we want to know. It's no business of yours." But I knew it was. I could see it the way the two of them glanced at each other, and suddenly all the turmoil and the doubts exploded in anger. "You bastards put them up to it, is that it? Is that what you're scared of? That I'll identify them and they'll involve you?" Scunton moved towards me. "You shop them and we'll..." But the other man interrupted him. "I'll handle this, Bob." His voice was quiet, a hard, flat voice. "You were recognized. One of the neighbors, a man. The police will expect a statement." He paused, the disconcerting gaze sliding past me. Then suddenly he asked, "What were you doing standing there in the rain outside number 5 Washbrook Road?" I hesitated, unwilling to explain myself to men I knew would never understand. "You weren't at the meeting that night?" "No." There was a mood of violence, I said. A lot of threats were made, mainly directed at Pearson and Watt, and the yard foreman. "We believe in solidarity," Scunton growled in that thick voice of his. "Pearson and Watt were the one yard..." You believe in violence, I told him. All right. Maybe we do when it's necessary. I turned back to face the other man. If I hadn't been there, Bucknell and that fellow Claxby might well be facing a murder charge.
So you know who it was, Scunton cut in.
Yes, I said. I know who they were. And suddenly I didn't care. If you want to throw petrol bombs, why the hell don't you have the guts to do it yourselves? And to risk innocent lives, a little girl?
You threw it.
His voice was so quiet, it stopped me like a bucket of ice-cold water. That's what we came to tell you. Staring at him, seeing the hard, bitter line of his mouth, the cold gray eyes glinting in the gleam of the deck lights, I felt suddenly scared of him.
Who are you? I asked him.
He gave a little shrug, a shut look on his face.
We have a witness.
He pulled a packet of cigarettes from his pocket and offered me one. And when I pushed it away, he said,
You were alone. Nobody to corroborate your evidence.
He took out a cigarette and lit it, the movement of his hands deliberate. He was giving me time to take it in.
So it'll be your word against his. And the man who will say you threw the petrol bomb is a local man. He'll make a good witness.
Get out. My hands were clenched, the words coming through my teeth. He didn't move, drawing in a lungful of smoke and staring at me.
Bucknell doesn't matter, but Claxby is too useful a man to be thrown away.
Get out of here.
You could be useful, too.
He said it reflectively, as though considering the matter. Then he shrugged.
But at the moment, we're concerned with the East Coast Yards. We failed with the trawlermen. The fisheries officer of their union won't play. But if we can hold the strike long enough, then there'll be very little fish coming in anyway. That'll give the unions the leverage they need in their negotiations. A trial, with two militants in dock, wouldn't suit us at all.
He paused, and then added, We were able to have a word with your radio operator before coming here, in a pub.
You're out of a job again, it seems.
And when I didn't say anything, he smiled. He told us he thought you ought to be commanding a supply ship. That's where the future lies, isn't it? He was looking at me again, and the expression of his eyes had a speculative quality.
Get into oil, he said quietly, and forget about what you saw on Washbrook Road.
He stubbed out his cigarette, then turned abruptly towards the door, jerking his head at Scunton.
Think about it, he said over his shoulder. All you need tell the police is that it was too dark to see who they were.
And if I tell them the truth? He swung round on me.
Then you'd be a fool.
And he added, You keep your mouth shut, and I'll see our witness does the same. You understand? He stared at me a moment. Then he nodded and went out, Scunton following, their footsteps sounding hollow as they went down the ladder and across the deck to the gangway. And after that I was alone again, still in my pajamas and feeling cold. I got myself a drink, my hands trembling, wishing, as I had done so often in my life, that I had somebody to fall back on, not just a legendary figure of my father, but somebody, something, to give me strength. And suddenly I was thinking of the islands seen the previous evening, black against that green strip of sky. Shetland, the land where my father had been born. I had never been so close to Shetland before, and sitting there, the brandy warming my guts, it gradually came to me that now was the moment. I would go north to the islands, now while I had the chance. 2. My first sight of Shetland was a lighthouse sliding by the window, and green lawn slopes falling from rock outcrops, everything fresh and clean, touched with the luminosity of evening light. The Highlander landed, and I saw the remains of old wartime buildings as we taxied in to park beside a large British Airways helicopter. There was a light drizzle falling, and as I stood waiting on the apron for my baggage, the smell of grass and the sea all about me, I had a deep sense of peace, something I hadn't felt for a long time. Most of my fellow passengers were oilmen returning to the Redco rig. For 10 minutes or so, they filled the little prefab terminal with color and the babble of their accents. Then they trooped out to the waiting chopper, and in a buzzsaw whir of engines and blades, they were lifted up and whirled away. Suddenly, everything was very quiet, only the rattle of crockery as a woman went round the tables collecting empty cups, the murmur of voices from the BA desk where the dispatch clerk was talking to the crew of the Highlander. There was an ordnance survey map on the wall. I got myself another cup of coffee and stood looking at it, refreshing my memory based on the Shetland charts I had pored over on the bridge of Fisher Maid. Somewhere ahead is the southernmost point of the whole island chain, the tip of a long finger of mountainous land jutting south from the main port of Lerwick. The distance by road looked about 30 miles. A voice at my side said, "Can I help you?" He was a small man in blue dungarees, dark-haired, with bright blue eyes and a ruddy face. "I want to get to Hamnavo," I said, and pointed to the little port, which was at the north end of the island of Westborough, a little below Lerwick, but on the west coast. He ran a car hire business, but when I said I couldn't afford to rent a car, that didn't seem to worry him. "Hamnavo." He shook his head. "Don't know anyone going to Hamnavo. You'll have to go to Lerwick first. There's a bus in the morning, or maybe I can fix you a lift. Either way, it means staying the night." And he added, "My wife can fix you bed and breakfast, if that's any help." His name was Wishart, and I stayed the night with them, in a small house above Sunborough Village, with breeze-block outbuildings in which he kept his cars. He had been a mechanic servicing local farm vehicles until the oil company started drilling off Shetland. "Now I've got a real good business, not just tourists, you see. It's all the year round. Oil executives, contractors, technicians, commercial travelers. We've never known it so good." His face was beaming. "Yes, but how long is it going to last?" his wife said quietly, and behind her words was the experience of hard times. "Ah!" His eyes glanced quickly round the neat little parlor, with its gleaming new furniture and bright chintz curtains. "That's the question, isn't it?" We had finished the meal, and were sitting drinking whiskey out of a gin bottle. The whiskey had a strong, peaty flavor. "You being from Aberdeen, maybe you know the answer to that." I shook my head. "I'm a trawlerman." "Trawlers, eh? You looking for a job up at Hamnavo?" "Maybe," I replied cautiously. "It's a lot smaller than Lerwick, you know. You'd do better in Lerwick." He poured himself another finger of the pale liquor, topping my glass up at the same time. "Only this morning I rented a car to a man wanting to get hold of a trawler cheap, something you do with one of the rigs. But there aren't any big boats up here, only peary ones, and there's none of them going cheap. Anyway, the fishermen here, they hate the oil companies. They're scared of what could happen. The Torrey Canyon was bad enough, but suppose one of these production rigs blows, particularly if they strike oil to the west. Then all of the Shetland fisheries could be destroyed, millions of tons of oil polluting the seas for miles around. That's what scares them." He looked at me, his eyes very bright. "Dangerous bloody game anyway. Trawling, I mean. There's just been one of them wrecked. Went ashore yesterday in a northeasterly gale. Skipper dead and two of the crew injured."
"The Duchess of Norfolk?"
He nodded. "That's right. Drifted into South Nesting Bay. Here they beached her in the east voe of Skellister. That's all right until another northeaster piles the seas in. You mentioning Hamnavo reminded me of it. The skipper came from Hamnavo. Now what the hell was his name? Not a Shetlander. Norwegian, I think. You ever been up to Graven?" And when I told him I had never been to Shetland before, he nodded, staring into his glass. "An old wartime base like Sunborough here, but bigger. They had seaplanes, Catalinas, and a big airfield. And Scalloway, that's where the Norwegian boats were based after they moved from Lunna, landing men-at-arms in Norway, bringing refugees out. I was only a peary boy at the time, but my dad was up there, a blacksmith, fixing armaments, all sorts of odd jobs." And he went on to talk of his father, the stories he had told, until it was almost midnight and his wife chased him off to bed. It rained all night. I could hear it drumming on the slates. But in the morning the sun was shining, a magnificent view of sea and rocks and greensward, all sparkling in the freshness of that early northern light. I left with the post van that had brought the mail down from Lerwick, the washed brightness of land and sea calling to something deep within me. We passed under Ward of Scouseborough, Mosey Hill and Hallowley, the road dropping down to the sea, vistas of blue water stretching away to Bressay and the Isle of Noss. It was all new, an island world, yet I felt at home, and the remoteness of it seemed suddenly to cut me off from all the rest of my life. It was a strange feeling, and I sat there beside the postman hardly saying a word. He dropped me about 3 miles from Lerwick, where the Scalloway Road came in from the west. "You won't have to wait long. Anybody will give you a lift." A breeze had sprung up, a cold little wind from the north. I lit my pipe, watching the red van disappear. I was alone then, the hills all around me, sheep noises, and the sea down in the valley. Would anybody at Hamnavo remember my father? I didn't even know when he had left the place. My mother might have been able to tell me, but I hadn't written to her in years. And anyway, she was dead now. She had never been to Shetland, never talked to me about his early life. A builder's truck, loaded with breeze blocks, took me to the outskirts of Scalloway, where the road to Hamnavo turned off to the south along the placid waters of the East Vaux. A small drifter was anchored under the castle, seabirds lying to their own reflections, and I could see water stretching away beyond the bridge that joined Trondra Island to the mainland shore. I was there about 20 minutes before a tourist gave me a lift into Hamnavo. It was lunchtime then. I bought some biscuits and cheese, left my bags at the store, and strolled up a grass track to sit on the bank below some cottages. A purse-seine fishing boat was coming in round the headland, another moored at a concrete pier, both of them wooden-hulled and painted black. The woman in the stores had told me there was nobody of the name of Randall in Hamnavo now. She had said something about a plaque in the church, but when I went there after my lunch it was locked. There was no pub, and the few people I met had never heard of him. It was the teacher up at the school who suggested I talk to Miss Manson, an elderly spinster living at Braw, about a mile down the road towards Grunsound. But the wind had backed westerly, and it was raining then. I found lodgings in a little house on the hill that had a bed and breakfast sign in the window and was full of children. It was a bleak place, looking north to a scattering of islands half hidden in the rain. The man was away at sea, the woman uncommunicative, and the radio blared incessantly. As darkness fell, I walked down to the pier. But there was nobody there, the two fishing vessels silent and deserted, and Hamnavo itself a dead place, wrapped in a wet blanket of low cloud. I was walking slowly back, my head tucked into the collar of my anorak, when a shaft of light shone out from a cottage doorway, and a voice said, "You the stranger been asking about Alistair Randall?" "Yes," I said, and he invited me in. He was a beaky, tired-looking man with thin white hair and a nervous blink to his eyes. The door closed behind me, and I was in a cozy little room with a peat fire. A little old woman, very plump, sat in her knitting chair, the needles clicking, bright eyes watching me out of a round face that showed scarcely a wrinkle. "My wife," he said, and I was conscious of an atmosphere in the room, an undercurrent of strain. "Mrs. Sandford knew the Randalls." She nodded, an almost imperceptible movement of the head, the knitting needles clicking away, and her eyes fixed on me with a strange eagerness. "Can you tell me about Alistair Randall?" I asked. Her eyes dropped to her knitting, and there was an uncomfortable silence. Her husband smiled at me, blinking his eyes. "He was here all one summer." It was very warm in the room, and I unzipped my anorak. "You did know him, then?" The knitting needles stopped, the room very still, and she was staring at me again. "Who are you?" she asked. I hesitated before replying. Since leaving the Fisher Maid, I had been using my mother's maiden name of Fraser, just in case they tried to follow me. But now... "My name is Mike Randall," I said. "Alistair Randall was my father." The sound of her breath was like a sigh, and she nodded slowly. "Yes, I see now. The eyes, of course. We did wonder, Albert and me, when we heard you had been making inquiries."
That strange eagerness was back in her eyes as she gazed up at me. "From America, aren't you?"
"I was brought up there. I left when I was 20.
She seemed disappointed.
"But your mother, she went out as governess to a rich businessman and then married him. During the war, I think."
"Yes, during the war."
"Muriel," she nodded. "Her name was Muriel. Is she still alive?"
I didn't say anything, and she turned to her husband.
"Give Mr. Randall a chair, Albert, and a glass of whiskey to keep out the damp."
She asked me a lot more questions then about myself and what I had done with my life.
"So, you didn't come to see me?"
"I came to find out about my father."
"Did you know I wrote to your mother?"
"No."
"It must be 3 or 4 years ago now."
"She shouldn't have written like that," her husband said, his voice gentle, almost apologetic. "I told her not to."
"Life hasn't been easy for us," she muttered angrily. "Both of us getting old now, and Albert hasn't worked in 20 years. It was my son insisted I write. Did your mother never mention I had written to her? Mrs. Graber, Bayview, Narragansett, Rhode Island, USA. That's right, isn't it?"
"I think she must have written her for money. And because she was disappointed that I hadn't come to Hamnavo in answer to that letter, it took time and patience to get her to talk about my father." Her husband hardly said a word. He was from Scalloway, and I don't think he ever met Alistair Randall. But she had virtually grown up with him, for the Randalls had had a small farm at Hoos on East Burra, and her eldest brother had kept a lobster boat down in the Vaux of North Hoos. "Alistair often came out in the boat with us." The softness of her voice, the faraway look in her eyes, I sensed there was something more. But all she said was, "He was a very wild boy." He had gone to sea at the age of 15, on an inshore boat fishing out from Hamnavo. Then his father had died, the farm was sold, and his mother had gone to live at Easter Wharf, which was where she had come from. "I didn't see him for a long time after that. He got a job on a Lerwick drifter, and when the Shetland Times printed his views on the working conditions of the island drifters, he started writing for the papers regularly, you see." She produced some faded cuttings from her work bag, and while I was glancing through them, she told me how he had shipped in a Danish cargo boat bound for Svendborg and hadn't come back for a long time. "Did he go on to Russia?" I asked, for the last of the cuttings was about whaling in the Barents Sea. But she didn't know. "He only spoke of Denmark and Norway. Oh, and Finland. He had been to Finland."
"How long was he away?"
"Almost 3 years."
"And then he came back to Lerwick?"
"No, to Hamnavo. Of course, I was married by then. But you saw him again." She glanced across at her husband, a smile that had a quality of sadness. "Yes, I saw him again."
"Did he talk about Russia at all? He was a communist, you know."
She shook her head. "No, he never talked to me about Russia."
"How old was he then?"
She paused while she worked it out. "He was a year younger than me, so he would have been 23.
That made it 1930, for he had been born in 1907.
I asked her how long he had stayed at Hamnavo. "Just the summer, that was all. He was writing most of the time. A book, I think. But I never heard it was published. And he was gone before winter. He was a very restless man."
"Was that when he went to Aberdeen?" But she wasn't sure.
"I never heard from him again. Only at the end."
She delved into her work bag again. An envelope, this time. She held it out to me, her small hand trembling slightly.
"It was because of this I asked Albert to bring you in. I thought you must be a relative, you making inquiries of him here. He will have written it just before he was killed. You can read it if you like. I don't mind."
The envelope was dirty and torn, and it had no stamp on it. The address was in pencil, barely readable. Mrs. Anna Sandford, Hamnavo, Shetland. The letter inside consisted of two sheets of ruled paper taken from some sort of notebook, a thin penciled scrawl that had obviously been written under great tension. It was headed Somewhere Outside Madrid, and dated February 25th, 1939. Darling Anna, we are cut off and being shelled to hell. We have held on now for 28 weary months. Not much food and bitterly cold. The communists have pulled back, our flank exposed. Tomorrow or the next day I shall probably be dead. In these last hours I think of Shetland and of you. There's not been much of happiness in my life, and what little there has been I had with you. A pity I ever left the islands. But a man's destiny lies in himself and is unavoidable. It has led me inevitably to Spain, where we have played out the overture for a new world war, the bright hopes of youth lost in this mess of blood and cordite. You may think it strange that my thoughts are with you now, and not with my wife, but Muriel is a realist, whereas you are the essential woman, the mother earth of my native islands. God keep you and Shetland in peace during the Holocaust to come. I pray for you, as I hope you will sometimes pray for me. Your loving Alistair. I read it through twice, trying to visualize his circumstance at the time of writing, crouching in a trench on the crumbling perimeter of Madrid. And the writing, so overcharged with emotion, the Highland half of him crying out for pity. For prayer, too. I looked across at the woman so still beside the fire. My mother said he used to write poetry. She took the letter from me, staring down at the two faded pages. During the summer, yes, I suppose it was poetry. It didn't rhyme, and I didn't understand it, you see, so he never showed me any more. Her eyes were beginning to weep, and she turned away, stuffing the letter back into her work bag. One of his brigade brought it more than a year later. That was just after our troops had been evacuated from Norway. He was an RAF sergeant then, stationed up at Graven. Brought us some sugar, too, didn't he, Albert? Her husband blinked and nodded. His name was Pettit, a kind man. We were very short of sugar, you see, and with a growing boy... Her voice trailed away. Those were difficult times here in Shetland, you know. And she began knitting again. It's for my son, she said. He was here today. And her husband said, the first time in more than a year. That undercurrent again. And as soon as I had finished my whiskey, I left them, hurrying back to my lodgings while the words of that letter were still fresh in my mind. In the bare little room I wrote it down, I think exactly. And then I went to bed, and for a long time lay awake in the dark, thinking of his disillusionment, and how it matched my own. To die on a battlefield for something you no longer believed in. And his last letter, not to my mother, but to this woman in Shetland. The mother earth of my native islands. The call of his homeland, perhaps. Is that what we cling to at the point of death? The only picture I had ever seen of him was in my mother's sitting room in the big house on Rhode Island. It had been tucked away in a drawer full of odds and ends, a photograph taken outside the registry office in Edinburgh where they had been married. I remember my mother coming in and finding me standing there with it in my hand, the cold, contained fury with which she had whipped it away from me and torn it up. So long ago now that I could barely remember what he looked like, only the eyes, which had seemed to stare at me out of the print, and the fact that he was shorter than she was, and his suit crumpled. The wind blew all night. It was still blowing in the morning, but the clouds broken now, and fitful gleams of sunshine. I started out for Braw shortly after 9, walking south along the back of Westborough, the grass all green and the sea sparkling. I found Miss Manson feeding chickens in the backyard of her cottage, a tall, gaunt woman with steel-rimmed spectacles and a waspish tongue. The schoolteacher had warned me she was as full of gossip as a cat with kittens, so I didn't tell her who I was, only that I was a relative. It didn't satisfy her, of course, but she couldn't stop talking, chiefly about Anna Sandford and the dance she had led her husband, running all over the island after Alistair Randall so soon after they were married. And that son of hers. Serves her right. He was always a hard boy, and now he's up in Unst and hardly bothers with them at all. Well, there's little of Albert there, you know. The poor devil. I don't think she had known my father at all, only the gossip. She was a good deal younger. But she could remember the farm being sold, and she showed me the dower chest her mother had bought at the auction, a plain oak piece, carefully polished. Some people called Yunsen live there now, and she told me how to find it. She also told me that the plaque I had heard about was not in Hamnavo Church, but in Grunsound. Grunsound was another mile down the road. There was a little war memorial where the road to Hus branched off to the left across a stone bridge, and the view down the South Vaux was a bright vista of water, flat as a mirror in the sun. The church was just beyond the bridge, a small stone building close by the school. Fresh-dug earth, black as peat, was piled in one corner of the graveyard, and the church door stood open. It was dark inside, and stark in its plainness. The plaque was at the west end, and the inscription, etched in black on the plain brass, read, Alistair Mowat Randall, journalist and soldier who died in the Spanish Civil War, 1939. No, when the fight begins within himself, a man's worth something. Browning. I stared at it for a long time, wondering who had put it there, the date of death not given, nor the side he had fought on, and those lines from Browning. Was it my mother? Had she made that strange choice of an epitaph? I turned to the nearest pew and sat down, wishing I knew the rest of that poem. Footsteps on the gravel outside, and a single bell in the roof struck an uncertain note. It struck again, and then again, a slow toll, rhythmic as the strokes of an oar. The door swung open, the sunshine flooding in, and then four men bearing a coffin on their shoulders. There was no music, only the tread of their feet to act as a dirge. They laid the coffin down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.